Our next speaker is Dr. Rashmin, and it's an absolute pleasure to introduce Dr. Rashmin, a very good friend who will be talking on making sense of anti-mog and anti-NMO and when we should suspect what to do. And Rashmin, after his FRCS, underwent his neuro-ophthalmology training at Wilmer Eye Institute. He's the consultant at Center for Sight and director of Foresight Worldwide, and he's taking Indian ophthalmology all over the world. And he's an outstanding person, an extremely affable and very nice person. And it's always a pleasure to listen to Rashmin. Rashmin, your floor.
Thank you so much, Rohit. Maybe I'll allow you one more minute and introduce me a little further because we have time, since such a nice introduction. But thank you so much. I would like to thank Dr. Chitra, Dr. Rohit, and everybody at AIOS ARC for inviting me for this talk. A part of what I'm going to cover has already been discussed by Rohit, Ambika, Sachin, and Prem. Rohit has very nicely discussed what is typical optic neuritis, or what is a optic neuritis, typical optic neuritis as described in literature. But what do we see here, and when do we suspect the other bad forms of optic neuritis like NMOSD and MOG, and what do we do about it? That's the essence of my talk. So let's begin with this 42-year-old female with an acute loss of vision in the left eye a week ago. Her presenting visual acuity by 60 in the affected eye. She has RAPD in the left eye, while the right eye discs and fields are normal. Now, when you did the examination of the, and this is just a representative fundus, not of the same patient, you find that there is a florid or an impressive disc edema. So the question at this point in time is that, is it an inflammation or ischemia? When a patient comes to you with an acute loss of vision, these are the two commonest pathologies which presents to you with optic neuropathy. So in somebody who is above 40, ischemia would always be in the mix, and sometimes it'll be as the first differential. And what will guide you would be, in our case, let's say history. Both ischemia and inflammation will present to you with acute onset, but a typical optic neuritis will have a downhill course for around 2 weeks, plateaus, and then it starts improving with or without treatment. Well, NAION in most cases will have a loss of vision and generally will stay there, though 1/3 of the patient can have an up or down tick on the vision in the history. Now, as far as the presenting visual acuity is concerned, in a 42-year-old female who does not have a risk factors of arthritic AION, we are looking at a non-arthritic AION, and a visual acuity typically in a non-arthritic AION would be around 6x60 and thereabouts. While in optic neuritis, it can be anything from 6x6 to no PL. So in our patient, the visual acuity is 1x60, which is not very common for any AION to present with. As far as the disc appearance is concerned, a non-arthritic AION typically occurs in a small disc with a small cup, what is described as disc at risk. While our patient had a florid disc edema in one eye, which is not so common in any AION, and the other eye disc, more importantly, was normal with a normal cup. So what you're looking at now is all the clinical features are probably taking you more towards an inflammation or an optic neuritis. Now, as Rohit mentioned, optic neuritis, it is not very common for optic neuritis to present with such a disc edema. That's what we were told by ONTT. We are seeing more and more, especially in India, we are seeing more and more patients who come to you with optic neuritis and disc edema. So our first differential in this patient would be some sort of atypical optic neuritis. Now, apart from this, when do I suspect that the patient has atypical optic neuritis? ONTT, around 90% of the patient complain of retrobulbar pain or discomfort. While our study in India, the pain was not such a major factor as ONTT, but absence of pain generally tells you that maybe this is an atypical optic neuritis. Disc edema, as Rohit mentioned, always takes you towards a spectrum of atypical optic neuritis, because a typical optic neuritis does not have impressive disc edema. Bilateral simultaneous presentation does not occur, almost never occurs in a typical optic neuritis. A severe vision loss on presentation with a very little change over a period of 2 weeks or 3 weeks tells you that this is not really a typical optic neuritis. Lack of response to steroids, recurrence, and other neurological deficits is where you start thinking of an atypical optic neuritis. What do we do next? As was mentioned by Prem, ONTT said that role of MRI was only for prognostication. If MRI lesions are present on presentation, then you know that this patient is going to develop multiple sclerosis. But that caveat is no longer true now, because MRI should be done in all patients, MRI brain in orbit with contrast, with fat separation. The reason being, because not only that it will tell you whether patient is likely to develop multiple sclerosis, now it will also give you a clue towards what is wrong with the patient. There are typical MRI picture features of both NMO and MOG, which will tell you that this patient is likely to be going towards NMO and MOG and not multiple sclerosis. So again, as I said, previous belief was that MRI is only for prognostication, but now more and more we are seeing that MRI also helps you to tell the cause of optimitis, and that's the reason why MRI brain in orbit with contrast should be must for everybody. And why did I say that? Because if you find that a whole segment of the optic nerve is affected, or the posterior part of optic nerve, chiasm and optic nerve also is involved, hemispheric cerebral white matter, areas in the brainstem, dorsal midbrain, area posterior, which is very typically affected in NMO. So if you find lesions in all these places, you know that you are dealing with NMO spectrum disorder. Now, why this is important, why we are stressing on really finding that whether patient is falling into this group of NMO spectrum disorder, is because NMO spectrum disorder is much more aggressive than typical optic neuritis associated with multiple sclerosis. The reason being, it is more likely to relapse. It is more likely to cause optic nerve damage quickly. And according to some studies, within 40% of the people within the presentation of optic neuritis is likely to develop paraplegia because of involvement of the spinal cord. And so because it is more aggressive disease, the prognosis is poor. And because they come to us first, that's the reason why these MRI features and the diagnosis or a high suspicion for NMO should always be there. These are some of the pictures showing, and this I've taken from American Journal of Neuroradiology. You find here that the optic nerve is lighting up, and also the chiasm, and the areas of the brain which are not affected in multiple sclerosis, but you will find they're getting affected in NMO, are seen here, medulla, tegmentum of midbrain. These are the areas which are generally not involved in multiple sclerosis on MRI. And that's the reason repeating MRI brain in orbit with contrast becomes very, very important. The other fellow travelers, when you have suspicion of NMO spectrum disorder, is weakness or paralysis in the legs and arms, painful spasm, loss of sensation, uncontrolled vomiting and hiccups. This is typically seen when the patient has involvement of area postrema, bladder or bowel dysfunction because of spinal cord damage. What do you do next? The confirmation of the diagnosis of NMO is by ordering a blood test and see whether antibody to aquaporin 4 is present in the blood. We also—
1 minute left.
NMO also can be associated with other immune-mediated disorders. So typically, we'll also ask for blood tests, rule out those. And lumbar puncture will always help to find out whether there's some infection going on. And as Prem mentioned, presence or absence of oligoclonal band or presence of white blood cell, which is seen more than half of the patients with NMO. The treatment was discussed briefly. IV steroids is must. And again, this is where there is a change. ONTT said that whether you give steroids, you don't give steroids, does not matter. While for NMO and other disorders, immediate IV steroids within first 2 or 3 days would really help. Low threshold for plasma exchange and for a chronic maintenance therapy and prevent relapses as a therapy in mycophenolate for a very long time. There are some newer drugs which have been FDA approved. A word about MOG. It has a similar spectrum. It was believed that maybe it is an NMO spectrum disorder, but it is more bilateral. It is more common associated with encephalitis. The age of onset is little lesser than what you find in NMO. NMO generally seen in 40s. MOG in children 30. Recurrence is less, better recovery. On MRI, you'll find perineuritis or even inflammation spilling over to the orbit and early treatment. And there is not much of a data. I'd like to hear from Sachin and Prem whether what's the role of PLEX, early PLEX in somebody who has a MOG antibody. So this is the last slide. We are talking about atypical optic neuritis. It can be infective or immune-mediated. Immune-mediated, you look at the blood, antibodies can be present. If antibodies is present, but there is no systemic condition, you're looking at NMO or MOG, or with systemic condition like SLE. If there are no antibodies, you're either looking at sarcoidosis or chorion. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Rashmi. Wonderful. Some questions?
Yeah.
Prem, would you like to elaborate on the role of Glenn Mogg, I'm not very sure about that. Would you also go and do early plasma exchange for somebody who has a Mogg optic neuritis?
We have not really been doing PLEX for MOG associated disease. And the reason for that is, unlike in NMO, where the aquaporin 4 antibody is clearly pathogenic, and so removing it from the body should decrease disease activity. As best as we understand MOG disease, it is a marker for the disorder, but it is not the necessarily pathogenic entity. And so the role of PLEX in treating patients with MOG, I think, is much less well proven. We have been fortunate that with MOG disease, we, like most others, have seen a very good response to corticosteroids, as you would expect. So our routine is to give them intravenous methylprednisolone and then a slow taper of oral prednisone over the course of weeks to ensure they don't have disease relapse. There's some evidence that perhaps IVIG can be useful in some MOG patients who are refractory to other steroid-sparing agents. That's work that John Chen of Mayo Clinic and others have done. I'm less convinced of the role of IVIG. I tend to use other steroid-sparing agents instead.
Do you see this neuromyelitis optica spectrum disorders without optic nerve involvement? And sometimes the neurologists send an anti-NMO positive and we find that there is no visual dysfunction. Is that possible, Dr. Crane?
Yes.
Sure. They could have just the transverse myelitis or some other CNS manifestation without optic neuritis. So that's definitely, if you look at the diagnostic criteria for NMO, if you have antibody positivity and core symptoms, and there are many core symptoms that are outside of the visual axis, then it is appropriate to give those patients a diagnosis of NMO. They're at high risk for developing optic neuritis without proper treatment, though.
Do you think in those subgroup of patients where there is no optic nerve involvement, but there are other features in NMO, doing OCT will reveal anything? Like in MS subclinical cases, you'll have a RNFL thinning. Do you have any experience that you'll find OCT thinning in these NMO spectra?
Very interesting. I have not systematically looked at that population of patients. I don't know if Sachin has any experience doing that. I don't have enough data to tell you. We know that NMO's optic neuritis causes severe damage to the retinal nerve fiber layer and macular ganglion cell complex. I have some work that we've done showing early OCT angiography changes in the macula of patients with NMO spectrum disorder. And so that may actually be a better way to try to pick up subclinical damage than just the structural OCT.
I have a question for Dr. Prem. What is your take on pediatric MOG optic neuritis? And what is the cutoff age for immunosuppressants in such cases?
So given the overlap between MOG positivity and ADEM in the pediatric population, I think there's a little more hesitance to put those patients on long-term immunosuppression. I think that's been the practice. I don't see as many pediatric patients maybe as some of you, so I'd be interested to know what you do. But we have been more conservative in terms of putting those patients on long-term immunosuppression. We taper them off the steroid, and then we watch them to see if there's evidence for any relapse, because it is more likely that they'll be monophasic.
And in cases of relapse in such key patients?
I think, again, that has to be a co-management with the pediatrician, trying to balance those risks of immunosuppression and leading to secondary problems that we don't want. And so I think, it's a harder decision. I don't know that there is a specific cutoff that I use. There's no specific cutoff age. It's more a matter of how severe their disease manifestation is, what the risk of the further vision loss or even neurological dysfunction might be.
Because I think we have a lot of difficulty and managing these children with relapsing optic neuritis, because the neurologists are very reluctant to keep them on long-term immunosuppressions, but they do end up in our clinics with multiple episodes. The moment we come down on steroids less than 20, they start with the next episode. Because many of them have a stunted growth, chronic steroid features. You have to find a steroid sparing drug, and they are so reluctant to move on to the next immunosuppressant, definitely with a lot of side effects. I think we have few patients where they have put on Mycept for a longer duration, and we had a lesser recurrence. And they were those children who came with repeated relapses of neuritis, would turn out to be MOG positive disorders. in our group of patients. So when do you choose to do an MRI spine? When do you advise, Dr. Rashman, in any neuritis, if they don't have any LETM or anything, or rather clinically, if they don't have myelitis symptoms, when do you decide that you need to do an MRI spine? Because we routinely ask for a brain in orbit.
Yeah, so is there is a clinical suspicion that this is going towards NMOSD, but you don't get that confirmation from MRI brain in orbit, then you are looking at confirmation from spine, because as Prem said, that blood is going to take a little time for you to get the results. So that's where, and what you're looking for obviously is involvement of three or more vertebral segments in the upper spine. Prem?
Yeah, I think it's guided to any, absolutely. You may get an answer more quickly with the spinal imaging than the serologies, and to support a diagnosis, particularly in those patients who, again, present with atypical features, or they are outside of the normal age for typical optic neuritis, or they have very poor vision.
Like a bilateral presentation, bilateral retrobulbar neuritis, probably right. You can ask for a spine to begin with. Maybe it can guide. And I think OCT, is it anything to do with the vertical segments? Towards the polar regions, do they have an RNFL thinning much more compared to the nasal and temporal? When we do an OCT, will it give any guidelines for us?
I'm not convinced of the role in the acute phase. I'm really not a fan of trying to differentiate among different optic neuropathies in the acute phase with OCT, because I think there's just too much overlap.